Thank you for coming again. Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay, good. Just by show of hands, if you would for a minute, how many of you were here last night? Ooh, almost everybody. So is there anyone new? Anyone? Yes? A couple? Great. For those of you who were here, you'll pardon me for repeating some of the introduction you heard last night. Also, there may be some people watching the video, part two for the first time. So in any event, welcome to part two of Geshe Pema Dorjee talking about the Bodhisattva's way of life by Shantideva. I will tell you much briefer than last night about Geshe La, who is, as you know, a scholar, a teacher, and a humanitarian. He was born in Tibet to a nomadic family. They escaped from the Chinese when he was 9 years old by crossing over the Himalayan mountains at night on foot. Ultimately, he attained his Geshe degree in India and ran for many years TCV, the Tibetan Children's Village. For some time, he also ran the Institute for Higher Buddhist Studies. His Holiness asked him to try and revive the Bodang tradition, a branch of Tibetan Buddhism that had become almost extinct. And in this regard, he has organized and continues to run a group that unearths the old writings, translates them, and publishes them. As tonight's lecture and this whole series demonstrate, he spends a lot of his time teaching about compassion. But not only does he teach about it, he truly practices it. His projects, I named a few of them last time, run the gamut from having established orphanages and schools, to bringing clean water to remote villages, to providing a safe home for street children, helping at a drug rehabilitation center, talking with villagers about how to avoid becoming victims of human trafficking, providing medical care, including an eye clinic, which brings everything from eyeglasses to eye surgery to almost totally unreachable villages. More recently, the monks at the monastery that he runs in Kathmandu were bringing blankets and rice to people who needed them after the earthquake. And one of the recent projects involves something we discussed at greater length yesterday, which is bringing clean cook stoves to places where the hut that often holds three generations in a single room has a fire that burns constantly day and night, causing blindness and pulmonary problems. As a scholar and teacher, Geshe La lectures all over the world, and we've been very fortunate to have him visit America the last several years, and in particular the Tibet House, which has been gracious enough to host him for the last, I think, five of those years. To help support Geshe La's humanitarian projects, we established an organization called Tibetan Buddhist Charitable Aid, or TBCA, which is a 501c3 charity. 100% of your donations go directly to the projects, so 100% would be tax deductible. Of course, as a teacher of Tibetan Buddhism, he never charges anyone, anywhere, anything for his talks. But as people who are involved with TBCA, we do ask if anyone is interested in contributing to his projects through TBCA, feel free either to see my wife Carol or me afterwards. And for those of you watching this on the internet, just go to BuddhistCharity.org. Enough about Geshe Pema Dorjee. We turn to part two. Thank you, sir.
You know, Lama Goma Yemela, Dani Gue, Josia, Dosun, Josia, Yonga, Lama Yemela, Dani Gue, Dosun, Josia, Pajamu, Lama Goma Yemela, Dani Gue, Josia, Dosun, Josia, Yonga, Lama Yemela, Dani Gue, Dosun, Josia, Pajamu, Lama Goma Yemela, Dani Gue, Dosun, Josia, Yonga, Lama Yemela, Dani Gue, Josia, Pajamu, Lama Tajin Chinanangi Sanya Chana Pemu Tenzin Jazola Sova Jazo Shedun Lundu Yisho. A little bit about motivation. Yesterday I didn't say anything about motivation. And I think according to the tradition, and to say something about motivation is very important. So the motivation, we are just here about two hours yesterday and 2 hours today, and hopefully another few hours in future. So our motivation of gathering here should not be just to expect some, from my view, okay, from my side, I should not expect any sort of money or some praise. And then from every one of us, we should not listen to the teaching just to show other people that I received his teachings, so I met him, and that was good, and I'm really, just, I think, for the sake of name and fame, and then some sort of like a business, or we should not listen with this motivation. Instead, we are just starting from the beginning, we should say that I really want to train my mind. I really wanted to train my mind to be a better mind, okay? Less destructive emotion and more good quality mind. And so I really want to train my mind so that this will be useful for everybody, okay? Everybody. So with this And then I really wanted to listen the teaching, which is, I think, one of the most profound and important teaching related with the how to cultivate bodhicitta and also how to enter into Bodhisattva's way of life and practice and to achieve Buddhahood for the sake of every sentient being. So with this motivation, without defiled or polluted by eight worldly conceptions, if we try to do it in a, with a pure heart, sincere, and to train your mind. So if you train your mind, then you will be able to help others to train the mind, you see. And therefore, the motivation here has a specific goal. That is, now, okay, we are going to listen the teaching of Shantideva, and then we try to enter into his teaching and try to practice step by step, okay. Ultimately, I will definitely try to cultivate or transform my mind into bodhicitta. And so that is the that has to be the motivation. That is for the sake of all sentient beings, okay, for the sake of all sentient beings. This is motivation. And then when I was reflecting what I talked yesterday, and then I thought that I better to ask a few questions to you. And if you give a good answer, then I will not repeat again. Otherwise, I have to again go back. But don't worry, okay. If there's answer, it's very good. If not, this is okay, you see. And then also I didn't explain about the name of the text, which is in Tibetan we say Chanjusev Chobal Chopa. Okay? And in Sanskrit, of course, these are translated in different translations. And I think all the translations are very good. But then I have to try to help you try to understand the name of the text. And then I will ask a few questions. Yeah. So Bodhisattva, okay? Tsariya, Avatara, Bodhisattva, okay. Buddhi is one, okay. In Tibetan, I think it makes a lot of sense to me. When it translated into English, then Bodhisattva's way of life, one translation. Another translation says that guide to the Bodhisattva's way of life, okay. Guide to the Bodhisattva's way of life. And so now I try to explain exactly according to the Sanskrit. Buddhi in Tibetan, we say Changchub. Changchub, okay? And Changchub is a big, big word. Changchub. And Chang has its own meaning, Chub has its own meaning, okay? Chang means that all the obscurations or the destructive emotions, subtle imprints of the bad karma and destructive emotions, everything is totally removed by using antidote, okay? That is chang, okay? To remove all the bad things, okay? Either it's in the form of imprint or in the form of gross level, okay? This is totally removed, okay, and it will never grow again, it will never come back again, okay, removed forever by using antidote. That is chang, okay, chang, one part. Chup is to acquire or to achieve all the good quality needed for one's own self and also needed for the benefit of all sentient beings. Okay, chang, chang, chup, okay, that is buddhi, okay. Buddhi. And then Sattva is Semba, okay, in Semba means the person who are aiming to achieve Changju, Buddhahood, or enlightenment. Okay? Changju, Bodhisattva. Tsariya is a Jopa. Jopa is a way of life, or Bodhisattva's activities, or Bodhisattva's mental, speech, physical action, everything. Okay, that is Tsariya. Okay, now, and another, I think that is enough. So therefore, here the translation, Bodhisattva's way of life, okay, Tsariya, and the Bodhisattva. Avatara is almost like, it is there in the translation, but it doesn't show so visible. So avatara is to enter or enter into practice, okay. Jukpa, in Tibetan we say Jukpa, okay. Changju, Sembe, Chöpa, La, Jukpa. Jukpa is to enter into the practice of Bodhisattva's activities, mainly six perfections, okay? Mainly six perfections. Avatara, okay, avatara. So now, the translation, Bodhisattva's way of life, or guide to the Bodhisattva's way of life. So now, this is all, I'm just trying to help make this more clear, you see. There's nothing wrong in the translation, but we have to make it clear that the understanding, okay? So that means, Changju Semba is that the Bodhisattvas who are aiming, okay, to achieve Buddhahood. For the sake of all sentient being, for the sake of all sentient being, and that is possible if they do the same as Bodhisattvas do, okay? Enter into the practice of the Bodhisattva as Buddha did, and then it is possible to achieve Buddhahood in the same way as Buddha achieved. Yeah. So Bodhicitta, Tsariya, Avatara. And then this, it's okay. Yeah. Yeah. So now the first chapter, if we just go back a little bit like recapitulation. The first chapter is benefit. And some translation is excellence of the Bodhicitta, okay? And in some translation they say the benefit of the awakening mind. All these are very good translation, but then I have to explain a little bit, you see. Awakening mind, okay? The awakened mind is Buddha's mind. And then by practicing Bodhicitta, and slowly, slowly, your mind will be awakened, you see. So now these days, instead of Bodhicitta, they also translate it as enlightened mind. Enlightened mind, okay? Enlightened mind doesn't mean that the mind which is already enlightened. This is not the meaning. The mind which is aiming to achieve enlightenment. Changju Semba, okay. Changju is enlightenment. Semba is mind. So directly translated, enlightened mind, okay? And that means the mind which is aiming to achieve enlightenment. And that mind is called enlightened mind. It's not like a mind which is already enlightened. It doesn't mean like this, okay? Yeah. So benefit. Changjusini Phoenicia, okay. First chapter is Changjusini Phoenicia. Pen Yun, again, Tibetan language is two terms, pen and then yun. Okay? Pen, I think, is benefit. Okay? And excellence, it can be, yeah, so benefit. Then yun is if the mind has to benefit other sentient beings, then the mind has to have many, many good qualities. Okay? And that quality is called yunden. Okay? Yunden. So therefore, you just think a little bit more, okay, in English translation, and then have to think, and then try to read more and listen more, so that you really get the meaning of the awakening mind or enlightened mind or whatever. Okay, yeah. So the first chapter, name of the first chapter is in Tibetan we say Changju Sem Di Phoenicia Ba. Changju Sem is Bodhisattva. Okay, Pen Yun, Pen is benefit. Yun is the quality. The Bodhisattva has so much quality as we talked yesterday. It has so like immense quality to remove the obstacles, and it has immense quality to cultivate or develop so many good qualities, and it can lead us to enlightenment. Yeah. That is because of the Bodhisattva. So Bodhisattva has this quality, as yesterday we explained, you see. And of course, all these bad things we did in previous life, it's accumulated a lot, you see, bad karma, all this. So many things, it's huge. Our mind is overloaded, as I explained yesterday. But then, if we are able to cultivate Bodhisattva, and these big sins or everything, this is just peanut. Easy, okay, easy. Because the Bodhisattva is so powerful, so powerful. Why is it so powerful? Because it is aiming to all sentient being, aiming for the benefit of all sentient being, without differentiating anybody, okay? Without differentiating anybody. Even someone, okay, as Chandkirti explained in his valid cognition, means one who is giving a very good massage with a very good motivation, with a very friendly sort of approach, and one who is, the X cutting, okay, cutting, and then the Buddha has no difference, okay. Both are the object to be benefited, helped, guided, you see, no difference. So that is possible only if someone has Bodhisattva, you see. So therefore, Bodhisattva has so much benefit and so much good quality. And then also in the Shantideva's first chapter, he says that if someone, okay, who's very old, teeth are rotten, and hairs are really like nest, and everything is crumbled like this, okay, if that person has a Bodhisattva, the whole Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and everyone will prostrate to this person because of the Bodhisattva. Therefore, why Bodhisattva is very powerful? Because of all these things, okay? And then some of the good karmas, what we earn, if I could earn good karma today by giving some food, okay, today, if I earn this, if I use the result, if I use next life, and it will be completely exhausted, you see. But if we earn a good karma, or by giving something to someone out of generosity, and that becomes a perfection of generosity, and then it will never exhaust it, because it is aimed to achieve enlightenment for every sentient being. Therefore, more we use, it will multiply, it will never exhaust it, you see. And that is the power or the benefit of the Bodhisattva. Therefore, when you say Bodhisattva has so much power, oh, like mountains of sin can be removed easily if we have bodhicitta. It's really hard to believe, but then also to cultivate bodhicitta is also very, very difficult, you see, because it is so precious, so powerful. We need to put a lot of effort. First important thing is we have to be really totally selfless. Self-cherishing attitude has to be totally removed, you see. And this self-cherishing attitude has to be substituted by the motivation of helping others. And up to now, we have been focused only for one person, you see. The capacity is very small. The potential is very small. After changing our mind into bodhicitta, then it covers all, okay, all. Therefore, it's very powerful. Just therefore, I say, chapter one is benefit of the bodhicitta, or benefit of the awakening mind. Benefit is pemba is benefit. Yun is the mind has a quality, a good quality, to be able to benefit every sentient being. So it's, I think if you read the English translation, benefit of the enlightened mind or awakening mind or excellence of the bodhicitta. So you have to understand this, okay? When you read this, you have to understand this. I'm just helping, okay? I'm not correcting translation. I'm not saying anything bad about translation, but I'm just helping to get a better understanding, okay? Based on the Tibetan text. Now these days, even it is in the Sanskrit, but still I think it's very difficult to understand in Sanskrit. So they try to take the meaning from Tibetan and then try to understand in Sanskrit today, okay? Before it was Sanskrit, and then we try to understand from Sanskrit. Now we kept the essence of the meaning, everything. So now Sanskrit is almost like in a, like a scholar language, you see. That can't use in daily life. It's scholar language. Some people who are intellectual, they say they are very good in Sanskrit. Therefore, now they read in Tibetan and then try to make the meaning which are in Sanskrit. If they just read simply Sanskrit, to explain whole Shantideva's text is almost difficult, you see, now these days. Therefore, I think we can explain from the perspective of Tibetan language is, I think, quite okay. What do you say? then second chapter is short, very short. And then today we have to cover two chapters, okay? Which are quite tricky. And translations are also more difficult too. I think I need to explain quite a lot. Of course, we can't go word by word, but the meaning of the chapter, I at least I have to try to explain as good as possible, but I have also a lot of limitation and shortcoming. But I will try, okay, because we already scheduled. Okay, so I'm checking with them. some witness. Now, second chapter. Now, first chapter is motivating us. Okay, motivating us to cultivate bodhicitta. Wow, this is so good. Okay, it has so much potential. If my mind is transformed to bodhicitta, this will bring so many good qualities. It will remove so many contaminations and mistakes and everything. So this is so good. Okay, so good. Now I really wanted to cultivate bodhicitta. Okay, by reading, studying first chapter, you will get this motivation. And then you sit down and say, okay, now how can I cultivate bodhicitta? And then two questions arise. My mind, okay, is it really clean enough to cultivate bodhicitta immediately? If it is not clean enough, then we have to clean our mind, and then after some time, then you can cultivate bodhicitta, you see. If your mind is totally contaminated and a lot of distractions affect emotions, and then also some affect emotions are so strong, okay, we have so strong, it's like a living, and it is like part of our life. And then to cultivate bodhicitta is very, very far. Therefore, to bring this time of cultivation bodhicitta, to bring this first step is we Shantideva guided us. Say, you try to purify your sins and bad karmas, all these destructive emotions. Some translations say confession. Some say purification. Whatever, okay. But this chapter is mainly to remove, okay, to try to remove by doing prostration, doing some offerings, and doing some, saying some mantras, and thinking something, bodhisattvas and all these things, through this, okay, and then having strong, now I'm very, very careful to use guilty, because there are so many problems of guilty feeling, you see. But still I'm studying and thinking, because I meet so many people who has a lot of problem with this. So now, in Buddhism, guilty, okay, guilty means we have so much, oh, this is so bad, I did this, okay, I made this mistake, I killed that one, I stolen this, and then told this big lie, and so we have a strong guilty feeling, as if you have eaten a poison, dreadful poison, you see. If I add a dreadful poison, as soon as I come to know, then I will really run and go to the doctor, and as soon as I have to remove this poison, you see, in the same way, whatever bad thing we did, we have to have a strong guilty feeling and try to remove it. The best way to remove is to confess, to purify. And after purification, sincere purification, because we have like 100,000 prostrations, 100,000 syllabus mantra, and 100,000 water offering, 100,000 bodhisattva offering, 100,000 mandala offering, many. And these are very important, especially when you say in Geshe tradition. It's a very, very profound, you see. And then after doing this, all these preliminary practices, then your mind becomes clean, and then your motivation to cultivate bodhicitta will be much stronger, and then bodhicitta will grow within you or generate within you much easier. And you will stay longer, you see. So therefore, the second chapter says that you have to do the purification or confession. Okay? And after mind becomes clean, and then not 100% clean, but clean enough to cultivate bodhicitta, if it's 100% clean, then it becomes Buddha, you see. That is a little bit too much. So just clean, okay. Here the rooms are very, very clean. And sometimes too clean, it's like Buddha, okay. So rooms in India are quite clean. And rooms are in the remote villages are clean, but according to their standard, you see. Therefore, clean our mind, just enough clean to be able to cultivate bodhicitta. Okay? Yeah. And still we have to clean by using the bodhicitta, you see. and using the wisdom and bodhicitta and all, we have to claim more. So that is the second chapter. And after cleaning, you will sometimes, okay. Now this is very difficult to explain exactly. And some of the practitioner, not saying I'm not okay, but some of the practitioner, if their confession or purification becomes very, very effective, and then their whole dream changes, you see, dream changes. And then body becomes more light and look like less back pain and all this. And then mind also feels like things and like to do something, many, many meaningful things. And that is a sign that your purification or the confession was very successful. You see? And after that, then you can take the Bodhisattva's vow of perceptions. And this is translated accepting Buddhist awakening mind. This is one translation, okay? Another translation says accepting is one. There are few translations. I think I saw about five translations. But anyhow, I'm explaining from the Buddhist perspective. If you have this sign that, oh, so now I really wanted to cultivate bodhicitta, okay, for the sake of every sentient being. This is the most important thing. This is the most important. So you read, receive teaching, and then do prayers, and then meet a spiritual teacher, and try to read about the great spiritual teachers, the bodhisattvas, and then just all these factors, okay, all these factors become so strong impact on your mind that your mind cannot stay without cultivating bodhicitta. And then you take the bodhisattva's precept. Impossible, okay. Now these days, I don't know. We just take, it's very important, so we have to take Bodhisattva's precept or vow, because it is very important. And then, what is this? I don't know, but it is really important. So everybody says that this is very important. So I'm going to take the Bodhisattva's vow or precept. That is not enough. Yeah, main purpose of doing purification is your mind will be fertile land, fertile land, to be able to grow the seed of bodhicitta. Okay? Then it will easily germinate. Yeah. And then you take the bodhisattva precept. That is a third chapter, okay? Taking the Bodhisattva's precept or accepting the awakening mind, whatever. And of course, doing a lot of practice, if your mind is changed into Buddhist citta, that is very good. If that is not happen in your mind, then you can ritual, some rituals, through rituals, prayers, and visualizing all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And from the very qualified spiritual teacher, if you take Bodhisattva's vow, and then you make yourself to make an obligation or commitment to follow all those vows, precepts, you see? And this will help you to cultivate bodhicitta. And then slowly, slowly, meditation, real practice, and then taking this precept all together, and then I think the cultivation of bodhicitta will be much faster, easier. Okay? Just simply taking a ritual and a precept from teacher is not enough. Have to practice, okay? It will give a lot of aspiration. So this is third chapter in Chanju Sem Yonsu Sungwas. And now today, the fourth and fifth chapter. If we have taken the precept of bodhicitta, or bodhisattva's precept, vows, and then if we break, this is very serious, okay? Very, very serious. Why? In front of Buddhas and bodhisattvas, and every sentient being in front of them, say, I will try to cultivate bodhicitta for the sake of all sentient beings who are suffering, okay? I really wanted to make them free from suffering, and make them happy and help them to achieve Buddhahood, okay? You promise this in front of Buddha? Bodhisattvas, all sentient beings, spiritual teacher. If you pray, then this is very serious. And so therefore, to try not to break the vows, the precepts of Bodhisattva, and then this fourth and fifth chapter are very important. These chapters are very important. By studying this and contemplating this, understanding this, after taking Bodhisattva's vow or precept, and then this will help you to protect or guard, give it safe, or Bodhisattva precept. Therefore, what you say, sequences, order, so well organized, great spiritual teacher, you see. First this, and then second this, and these are all explained according to his experience, you see. He practiced this, he really practiced this, and he cultivated bodhicitta. He succeeded. And based on his experience, and based on Buddha's teaching, as I explained yesterday about the lung, okay, scripture, lung, in Tibetan we say lung, okay. Lung means, there are many, many scriptures, you see. There are so many scriptures, we need to do a lot of research, and we have to change them, or we can criticize them. But if it is lung by Buddha, there's no way, okay. If we do research, you will not find anything you need to change, you see. It's totally refined, totally well established, with experience, with logic, everything. Therefore, those are called lung, you see, which we can totally rely. If we analyze, we'll find the truth of this lung. If we practice, we will get the result of this loom. Why? One of the main reasons which we normally hear is Buddha has no intention to tell lie. Why? Because he has nothing. We have so many things to hide. Then we have to tell lie, you see. If I filled my bag with dollars, still I say, I have no single dollar in my bag. We have so many selfish thinking. We have to hide. And selfish thinking. Therefore, we have so many things to tell lie. But Buddha has no reason to tell lie. He has to tell the truth, okay? He has to tell the truth. Because he wanted to guide his disciple on the path of truth. And that too is not by reading book and doing research. That too is really he practiced, experienced, realized. And now he's telling exactly how he practiced and how he realized. Therefore, lung has a lot of meaning. Very, very, very heavy, big meaning. So scripture, translate into scripture. So you have to understand, to say, okay, there's no other words. Equivalent to lung, you see, they have to translate into scripture, you see. Okay, now fourth chapter. In Tibetan, we say Pawe, okay. Fourth chapter. Is it okay? Yeah. Huh? So still I didn't ask question, you see. Actually, I myself really don't know whether I'm swimming or I'm swimming in the lake of Bodhisattva Avatara, or I'm just carried by this. I don't know. So I'm just driving. you know, road in some remote villages, if we drive, nice car, even this nice car, but it is very bumpy. So my explanation is a little bit like this. Not so good, but I hope it makes some sense for you. And Paya. And then the difference between the fourth chapter and fifth chapter are very subtle. Okay? And therefore I say in the fourth chapter, Paya in Tibetan means try to avoid or abandon all the bad thoughts, bad action, and bad speech. Okay? Try to avoid this, or try to reduce this, or try to abandon this. And then try to do as much as possible the good things, good action, good speech, good thoughts. Okay? If we just remain our life in this sort of action or process, and then we are doing Paya. Paya, okay? This is Paya. Try to do all the good thing, and try to speak good thing, and try to think good thing, and try not to think bad thing, try not to speak bad thing. Okay, so if we remain our life in this way, and then we say, my life is spending in Paya. In one translation, carefulness. Maybe in this translation, is it Padmakara translation? Yeah, carefulness. Paya is translated as a carefulness. I think this is a good translation. And now I don't go there. Okay, now I'm explaining from the Tibetan, my understanding, from Tibetan language. Okay, Paya. And then I say, why I'm not going to, because I am a monk or I'm a human being and I have so much potential, I have so much opportunity. So if I do some bad thing, I think some bad thing, I speak bad thing, no, this is shame, okay, this is shame. So by thinking this, if you do all the good things, you are remaining in the framework of Paya, okay? Carefulness. try to fight against the bad things, bad thinking, bad action, bad speech, and try not to do this. And then this is another part of the Paya, okay? Combined together becomes Paya. And that person is, Paya, that person we can rely on him or her. Because that person is really Paya, therefore we can rely, we can trust. Oh, this is quite difficult, you see. I always put this example as airport, you see. We can't ask anybody, just please take care of my bag. I can't ask. Because announcement says that if you don't know the person, if you don't know the luggage, please don't take the responsibility, okay? Don't attend, okay? Unattended baggage. Please report to the police. I heard this a lot because I'm traveling a lot. Therefore, now it's very difficult to trust. If I say, okay, if I ask him to take care of my luggage, I have to go to the toilet, will he agree or not? A lot of conflict, insecurity feeling, you see. So I have to go with in the toilet and go to the toilet with my hand luggage and everything. If the toilets are very small, then it's very difficult, you see. But there's no way we can ask someone to, because we have so much suspect or doubt, and because of this, we have so much insecurity feeling. And this is really sad. This is very sad. You know? Yeah. So if the person is really pious, of course, if whole humanity on this planet are pious, then world will be perfect place. This is just building castle in the air, you see. So we can try from our end. We have to try, you see. Mm. When I'm talking about pious, and then there's a lot of explanation and how we have to try, okay? Mm. The second chapter, oh no, fourth, fifth chapter is, now I'm telling about the difference between these. Fifth chapter is mainly to check mind, okay? Try to check what is going on in your mind. Okay, what is, because the mind is the main creator, problem or good, anything. The mind is the main thing. So whether you use as a vigilant or alert or whatever term you use, in Tibet we say shishin sungwa, shishin. Shishin, the term shishin is mainly we use to check the mind, okay? Shishin charache. Shishin charache means shishin who checks the mind, what is going on in the thought, in the mind. Yeah, before this bad actions, bad speech, bad thoughts taking place, the shishin can check, and then if it is going towards that, and the shishin will check, you see, can stop. Therefore, the fifth chapter is mostly to protect your mind or to guard your mind by using the shishin, okay? Using the alertness and combined with the mindfulness. Yeah. Do you see the difference? When you read the text, you will not see very visible, you see? So, and then this is, these two are mainly to keep the Bodhisattva's way, Bodhisattva's vow or precept intact, not damaged, okay? Not damaged. When you take the Bodhisattva's vow from a very qualified spiritual teacher like His Holiness Dalai Lama, and in front of all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and all the sentient beings, if you take this vow, and this is a big thing, okay? And then to have this not damaged or defaced and keep this intact, and then to practice fourth and fifth chapter is very, very crucial. Yeah. No. Ho 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 ho. I think we better ask question. I think I did say quite a lot. I think this is enough. Or is it enough, or can you, is it enough, or Yes.
So you said mindfulness and awareness.
Huh?
Mindfulness and awareness.
Oh. Thank you. You said mindfulness and alertness are different. Can you explain that a little bit?
What? Mindfulness and alertness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you said they're different. Can you explain
no,
that?
No, no. Oh, I don't know in English, you see.
Oh.
I'm just differentiating from the Tibetan term.
Okay.
Shishi, Paye, and mindfulness and Temba.
Oh.
That I can explain. And then if you have some questions in Tibetan language, that will be welcomed. But in English, they use. And then always, because my mother tongue is Tibetan, so I always go back to Tibetan, and then I try to understand from Tibetan language, and then I try to translate into English, you see, based on my understanding. Of course, I read English text, English translation, I read. I take many things from there. And because of my limitation in English, I feel much easier and much comfortable to explain in my English. Yeah, taking my understanding in Tibetan in my head and then speaking my broken English, I feel much comfortable. Yeah. So alertness, if they use as a shishin, and mindful, they use a temba, okay? And then if, I don't know whether this will really give the meaning of alertness and mindfulness. I'm not sure, yeah. Mm.
You had, in a previous talk, talked about the importance of examining our life to see if we have, if we're living a meaningful, useful life. And the way to check, you suggested, was to check our thoughts. What are we thinking?
Yeah.
So to check how we're doing on our path towards bodhicitta could be kind of a slippery path, because if I say, how am I doing, or how I phrase the way I examine it, it could be about me, when bodhicitta is really not about me. It's what I'm doing.
No, it's not you. it is examining your practice. Yeah. how my life is going, okay? If I examine, then just examining my life, how it is going. Either it's going in a meaningful way or in a useless way, or that is our life. When you say like Bodhisattva's practice, examine Bodhisattva's practice means you read the Bodhisattva practice, okay, this is a Bodhisattva practice. So now am I doing exactly according to that, or am I going a little bit more than this or less than this or making a lot of mistakes? And that is the examine, you see. And through this, and you will see that, I think I'm quite a good practitioner. Yeah. Sometimes, no, I'm not a good practitioner. I have to improve because I made this mistake according to Bodhisattva's vow. I should not make this, but I made this. So I have to change tomorrow again. That is reflection, I explain. Okay, reflection. So that is mainly you are examining your practice of Bodhisattva. Yeah. For that, again, I will tell a little bit like this. In some place, I will say, some place. Once it was meditation, very important, When I went there, everybody is talking about meditation. And we discussed a lot about meditation, isn't it? What is meditation, why we meditate, how to meditate, when to meditate, all these questions, we have discussed a lot. I framed these questions because at that time the fashion was meditation. And after 1 year, the fashion lost, you see. So mindfulness. And then I was thinking, okay, I can deal with mindfulness this year, but next year what will be the topic, you see? Did Shantideva do the same? I don't think so. So then I was a bit suspicious, you see. Then I told my audience there, why you changed? Last year you were talking all about meditation, and this year now meditation is gone, and mindfulness. Why? Is there something wrong in meditation? Oh, you achieved all the meditation? Or you are frustrated about meditation? Why? And they really don't have concrete answer, you see. Concrete answer. And then I said, then I used a very bad word. I said, meditation is not underwear, okay? And we have to change time to time, you see. It's not underwear. We should not change like this, you see. It's not, whew. And then some places, even the spiritual teachers change like this, you see. Now, I'm quite old, so I experience a lot. So now, whether you practice mindfulness or alertness or whatever, okay, it has to have some aim. You see? Yeah? If you are on the practice, on the way to practice compassion, and then you have to use mindfulness, you see. Why? Because what are the factors which brings compassion, and what are the factors which are obstacle to the compassion? You have to remember this, you see. By using mindfulness, and you are so mindful that you will not bring all the factors which are obstacle to the compassion, and you will bring all the factors which makes you easy to cultivate bodhicitta, compassion. So then we should not forget this, you see. You have to really remember each and every obstacle and each and every factor, good things. Remember this, and then you have to practice this. As soon as some obstacles arise, you have to again say, then we use mindfulness plus alertness. Shishin. I think more question?
Yeah, we actually, back here, we have a question from this one of the streamers online. How can we, this is from Luigi, how can we pursue the end of suffering for all sentient beings if all sentient beings are different and have different kinds of suffering, some of which we may not even know about?
To remove the sufferings of any types of sentient being, we don't have to meet physically the person who is having suffering, you see. Yeah. Of course, Buddha passed away many, many, many years ago. Still, we are practicing Buddha's teaching, and it helps to reduce suffering. And to meet, if we have to meet Buddha and ask Buddha, please, now I'm meeting you, solve my problem, then this is not possible, you see. So therefore, we can receive teaching from any teacher, and we can practice, because we are human beings, we have all the potential and opportunity, so therefore, it's just up to us, okay, up to us. And to remove the suffering, one has to try. If I have to remove my suffering, I have to try. In Buddhism, even Buddha is there, okay, still I have to try. I can ask Buddha, okay, what is the technique, what are the techniques, what is this and what is this and how can we do, that we can ask. But actually, I have to try to remove the suffering. You see? Of course, I love my mother, okay? She has some suffering. I really like to remove her suffering and take on me. I feel like this. But it is not possible. In reality, it is not possible. So she has to try. We can support. We can give some guidance. We can give some comfort. But she has to try. Therefore, any types of sentient being, wherever, okay, everyone has to try. Try to understand the suffering and try to understand the solution of the suffering. That is the only way. Yeah. Yeah, so I think this is the answer. Yeah, yes, yes. I explained, I think, yesterday that Tumnam Dipa Chui Mituji Toya Dunga Chagamis, Yeju Toba Chang Lapom Chuni Demba Demba Toya Jur means Tumnam Dipa Chui Mituji. Even Buddha is there, still he cannot wash the sin or the bad karmas of the sentient being. Tumnam Dipa Chui Mituji. If there's someone has a big problem, like disease, dreadful disease, he cannot pick up the disease and throw in the garbage. It's not possible. Buddha has so many good qualities, and he has no attachment towards his good quality. He is ever ready to give any types of good quality he has, but it's not possible, you see, reality. His accomplishment cannot be transferred to other person who has a suffering. And then we ask question Buddha, then how can you help us? And he says, I will tell you the truth. I will tell you the truth. And I will tell you how to remove destructive emotion. I will introduce suffering. And I will explain where these sufferings are coming from. And I will explain how to remove these sources of the suffering. And you have to try and you will be free from suffering. In the same way, I practiced. I become free from suffering. Yeah, that is the reality, you see. Yeah. So in this way, we have to try. And if you ask me to remove all the sufferings of other sentient beings, and then I will say, excuse me. I can try as much as I, yes, as long as I'm alive, I will try. I can't promise that everybody's suffering will be solved by me. It's impossible, you see. Yeah. So this is the reality. This is the truth. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Did you want to take a little break?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. We break about 10 minutes. Yeah, 15 minutes is a little bit too long. 10, yeah. So is it my turn to speak or your turn to speak or ask? Because now we have only about 35 minutes and I can take some text from this fourth and fifth chapter and I can explain. But I'm really curious. You ask some question, then I will be awakened, you see. By hearing the question, then I will roughly calculate, okay, how much I have to teach depth tomorrow. Yeah. So you ask question in Tibetan language. Can you ask?
All right.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, try, please. In Tibetan language, okay? Yeah. Ko pyoge singido wa, dil singido. Now we are waiting, okay? We are waiting.
Kondas.
It's okay, yeah. Just
so much pressure. I can't do it in Tibetan.
In English, you say.
Yeah, okay.
Half English, half Tibetan. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'll ask you in Tibetan afterwards.
Yeah, yeah, please, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, so can you repeat the word again?
Changju. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I need to repeat again. Changju.
Changju.
The meaning of Changju.
Changju.
Okay. Buddhi. Okay. And then Sangye.
Sangye.
Sangye. Sangye means Buddha.
Sangye.
And Changju means Buddha. Okay.
Both
has a two syllables. Words, something like that, okay. Chang and Chub. Chang, Chub, and Sang, Ye. Sang, Buddhi is Sang, okay. Awake, awake, okay, awake. Mm. Why we are not awakened? Because we are wearing a very thick blanket of destructive emotions. So our mind is polluted. And therefore, our mind is not awakened. There's obstacle, you see, obstacle. To know something, we have obstacle. To see something, we have obstacle. To achieve something, we have obstacle. To cultivate something nice, again, we have obstacle, you see. And then the Buddha's mind is awakened because all these obstacles are removed. Now they have no obstacle, you see, to see or to understand, or and even the subtlest level of the imprints, okay, which are imprinted like millions of years ago, they can see. Therefore, in Shantideva's text, in this, in what we are talking in this chapter, he says, "Lezu samji mijaba thamje khenpo khone khen," means some people who practice renunciation and wisdom, practice, okay, they practice. And they achieve nirvana. Nirvana, okay? But then still, some of these people may have some bad karmas, imprints of the bad karma. You see? But then this bad karma will never be activated. Why? Why? To activate any types of bad karma need a destructive emotion, either desire or hatred, anger, or jealousy, then only it will be activated, you see. So this person who achieved nirvana has no destructive emotion. Therefore, even they have bad karma, it will never be ripened or activated into result. So those types of small, really tiny, tiny, subtle things, Buddha can see easily, but if we have to say, then we will be totally confused, you see. Because Buddha removed all those obstacles to see the subtlest thing. There's no difference between the karma earned today and earned millions of years. In the eyes of the Buddha, in the Buddha's wisdom, there's no difference, okay? He understands, you see. So therefore, Sangye, Sang is all the bad things are removed. Sang, as a chang, sang, same meaning, okay? And then chup is to achieve or to gain or to grow in the mind, good qualities, okay? In the fullest way, chup. And then we talk about two, okay? And dharmakaya and the rupakaya. Dharmakaya is the mental quality of the mind, Buddha. Dharmakaya, okay? And then Rupakaya is the Buddha's body. Yeah? And these two are achieved after removing all the subtlest obscurations and then cultivating, practicing method part of the Buddhism and then wisdom part of the Buddhism together. Yeah. So because of the practice of the wisdom part, he achieved Dharmakaya mainly, okay? And because of practice of the Bodhisattva and the method part, he achieved the Rupakaya. Why? Because having this body, and everybody can see and talk, hear, and smile, Okay? And then mind is difficult to see. But then the mind is really needed, you see, to tell, to teach about, to remove 84,000 destructive emotions. Yeah. 84 different types of destructive emotions to remove, the Buddha has to keep teaching. This destructive emotion needs this practice, the explanation, everything, you see. And that is possible only if he removes all the contaminations. Yeah. Therefore, we say sang ge chang chub. When you relate with the Bodhisattva, then always relate with Changjub. Changjub sem. Yeah. We don't say Sangya sem. No, we don't use Sangya sem. Pijutang marwa. Changjub sem. No, Pijutang marwa. In the Sangya sem, Pijutang marwa. No, we don't use Sangya sem. The meaning is same. Yeah. Yeah.
Obscurations that pertain to our own state and condition, but there's also a collective reality. Society that we live in, the world that we live in, there are forces that are exterior to ourselves. So we think of the English colonizers, and the French colonizers, and the Portuguese.
Now we go back to the Shantideva's text. he explains this, okay? And of course, it's one example, okay? There are many, many examples which are there. So one of the examples he explained was that, how Buddha achieved the perfection of generosity. Okay, how Buddha achieved perfection of generosity? Because there are so many poor people who have nothing to eat, nothing to dress. How can you say that Buddha achieved perfection of generosity? This was one question, okay? It's similar to your question, similar, okay? And then the answer is, okay, you have to develop a perfection of generosity by doing practice meditation. That if you have the opportunity to give anything whatever you belongs, and you have to develop that you are really totally 100% sure that you will be happy to give, you see, including your body. Okay, and that is the perfection of generosity. To remove all the problems is. In reality, okay, in reality, it is not possible, you see. If I remove all the problems of other people, and then it is almost like we are going out of the reality. If this is possible, beautiful, you see. Yeah, I have knee problem. If someone says, okay, I can take all the... I met one in Switzerland. He wanted to take my knee problem, okay? And he said, okay, thank you. I invited, and then I asked him to take. And then he did, And then he asked me, so how did you feel when I'm taking your problem? How did you feel? I have to say the truth. I said, I didn't feel anything. Then this is quite difficult, he said. Quite difficult, okay? And then, is it okay if I try again? Yeah. I have the photo. It's okay. And I said, yes, please try. Please try. And again, try it. And then he said very funny thing, okay? Oh, I think your energy is very strong. Okay? And then I said, okay, then is it okay if I take your problem, if you have some problem? Then I said, I don't believe in this, you see. I can't take his problem, and he can't take my problem, you see. Only we can suggest, you do this, and think in this way, and then also we can help like this, but I can't take. And then after that, he said, okay, I have so much energy and I really don't know where to put and where to store, and it's a so big problem, and then what you will suggest? And then I said, I think you better to use the energy. And then he said, yes, more I use energy, more I gain. And then I said, I don't know. I don't know whether this is really true or not, you see. But he didn't take my problem, yeah. That is that I know, you see. It remained his same. So therefore it is in reality, okay. In reality it is not possible. Yeah. This is the truth. Only we can help. Taking is not possible. Just only we can help. We are helping. One of my friends always said that, Pema, now you have to stop. All the time you are trying, you cannot change the whole world. I answered that, oh no, I'm not aiming to change the whole world. If it is possible, of course, I really like to try. In reality, it is not possible, but I'm trying. Even 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, I try. Just want to try, develop my mind. If there's a chance of helping everybody, if it is possible, ever ready to do this, you see, and then truly, in reality, it is not possible. Now. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I've come upon people at different times that suffer with this particular problem, you know, elevated uric acid. And people go to a doctor and they tell them they have arthritis and that the condition is incurable. Mm-hmm. And not infrequently, it's a simple question of elevated uric acid. It concentrates in the joints, it crystallizes. Mm-hmm. If you stop eating meat for 30 days and you eliminate vegetables that contain psyllium, the nightshades, like eggplant, tomatoes, etc. Within 30 days, that condition that on the basis of the nutritionist's advice, it cleared up just with that slight nutritional adjustment. And I've made that recommendation to other people and they've done that and their condition cleared up. Now I would say it's always the case. If you have serious calcification of the joints or if you have structural damage to the joints. Because what happens is that the uric acid that's elevated, that's concentrated in the joints, if you go on a diet like that, it dissolves and you're cured.
Very good, yeah.
Do you need to return to Shantideva? My question doesn't relate to diets.
It relates to the notion of devoting all of our energy and all of our motivation to helping others, which I'm sure you know sounds to those of us raised in the Western world as very idealistic. You mentioned a moment ago you would give your life if you could. But I'm thinking, if I gave my life, then I could help that person, but I would never be able to help anyone again. We're taught to take care of ourselves, because if we don't take care of ourselves, who else can we rely on to take care of ourselves?
Yeah.
So we have these thoughts like, if I give money, I will have no money left for, guess who, me. If I give my time, I will have no time left for, guess who, me, and so on. So how do we deal with the tension between trying to give everything to others and yet still protecting ourselves so that we exist in a reasonable way?
Yeah.
What about my suffering? Who will take care of that?
Very practical question, you see. The funny answer I can give is that we don't have to worry. It will take a lot of time, you see. So, till you really have the potential or a capability to give everything, it will take a lot of time. So therefore, we don't have to worry. This is funny answer, okay? A really funny answer. But then, if you have the mind which has a full potential to give everything, if you reach that sort of level, and then you really don't have to worry yourself. You see, there's no need to worry about this. And that also you don't need to give, you see. You don't need to give. If it's give, it's okay. If you don't give, it's still okay. But your attachment towards your belongings, that is the most tricky thing, you see. If I have a very strong attachment towards myself, I will be less healthy. I will be less good person, you see. More I detach, more I feel relaxed. Relaxed, you see. And then if I become more relaxed, then I will have more friends. If I have more friends, then if I wanted to help someone, then I will get a lot of helping hands. You see? So I think to cultivate sense of giving everything, or sense of giving, no, just cultivate a bodhicitta, or cultivate generosity within yourself to be able to give everything. If you achieve this practice, okay, and you will never become a poor person or beggar, never, never. Even if you become beggar, you see, still in your mind, you will be very happy. There will be no problem. The problems arise because we are trying to do, but always like we have some sort of sticky feeling, which I wanted to help. Okay, then, no, don't help so much. Then what you will be eating? No, I want you to give because this is so good. Now I want you to give house. No, if you give your house, then where you will live? Okay. And in between this, okay, then we really get tired. Yeah. So totally determined to give. And so the funny answer is also funny, but it carries some meaning. But this is the answer what I, based on Shantideva's teaching. Therefore, fifth chapter is to guard or to be very, very alert, vigilant, what is going on in your mind. If you really able to have a control or clear practice of what is going on in your mind, and that will change your speech, that will change your action, and that will change your attitude towards every sentient being, and including including all your properties or your relatives or whatever, okay, it will change a lot. And this change, okay, we think is quite, what do you say, negative or not so practical, not so comfortable or not so easy. And that is, we are seeing from the current state of the mind. You see, when you practice and your mind will develop, okay, if you see from that time, then you will not see anything what we are seeing today. Do I make some sense? Yeah. So when I read this legend novel, which is called Timekunde, and Korangi Kasureta Gundata, and Pugutu Samaji Batangirwa, and Mikta Samaji Batangirwa. So there's a legend. Legend is not necessarily to be fake, isn't it? Story. Legend means, this is really, of course we say legend story, but it is based on Buddha's teaching.
Legend.
Yeah, legend, okay. It's practice of generosity. Now we went to Namu Buddha, where Buddha gave his body to the tigress, hungry tigress. In the same way, this Harishchandra, and he was practicing the perfection of generosity. And then he gave all his wealth, okay? And then there were some people asking that, I need a child, so you have to give me your son or girl, daughter. And then, and started, oh, no, I need a wife, so you give me your wife. So he gave. He gave his eye, everything, okay, he gave. And when we went to Mustan, there were old people, about 60 old people, who were, time to time they get together and then they say, Om Mani Padme Hum. They bring some food and then some lama, they lead the prayer. And in between he tells story, or this story, and tell to the old ladies, old people, and tell this story. And then they stop, and then there's Om Mani Padme Hum with a very beautiful tune, you see, very beautiful tune. And then the money stop, and then he tells story about this. When I went there, they reached to the point that the Harishchandra achieved the perfection of generosity. And then I entered the hall. And then this Lama said, oh, this is so good. This is so, so important coincidence, you see. As soon as this finished, you came. And then I was there to give some money in the name of my old mother. Our group also collected some money. So I went there, I think something like 27,000 Nepalese rupee. And then I went there. And this teacher said, oh, this is a really very precious coincidence. And then he said, your generosity will be successful. Oh, I felt a bit ashamed. I said, but he said, okay. And then he asked me, tell something about you. And he told something about himself. And then all the old people were listening. And of course, I don't have anything to tell, but I just told, okay, I have a sweet old mother who is 95 at that time. Yeah, 95. So, and I start crying. I cried, you see. And she's nice. I explained about her, and then I'm giving this money, and I'm not rich at all, but I'm giving this money mainly for my mother, and all my friends, okay, who helped me in the difficult situation. So please say Om Mani Padme Hum for my mother and for all my friends, okay. And then I cried, and then all the old people also cried. And then the Lama also said, oh, now we really earned a good karma. We really earned a good karma that one day we will be born together. I don't believe, but he said, we will be born in somewhere collectively, okay, we will really accomplish the perfection of generosity. I didn't agree, but I didn't say anything. And he was also very emotional. The old people, Lama and me, because I cry quite a lot, quite often, you see. So therefore, mind is the quality of the nature of the different, I don't know, dimension. Is it possible? Different, it touches different things, you see, and it catches so many things, you see. As if, like, at that time, it was not my mind. It was just lifted somewhere that I felt that it was not my mind. When I come back, and then I went into my room, and then I felt that now my mind is with me. At that time, it was like almost like I was in trance. So the nature of the mind, is so much. It can go, always it can grow or develop infinity, which if we see from today, and that will be almost impossible, but mind can achieve. Therefore, the when he is guiding the mind, and he also says that why we went into hell, very, very, very serious sort of hot hell and cold hell, because it is we didn't protect or guard the mind. We let the mind become wild and let the mind do bad things because of the mind, and it happened. And then if we do something good, we achieve Buddhahood. That is also because of the mind. So then he says that the essence of having all these vows and to protect all these vows or to protect, is it okay? Yeah, and all these vows. And then he says, you should not underestimate this. This has so much potential to grow so huge that after growing this, if you reflect back, you will not be able to believe. Therefore, it has a stages, you say, stages. And then now there are so certain things going on in my mind which is quite difficult to explain. I think I have to stop. And I think we don't need to explain about burnout, isn't it? Just leave it. Yeah. Yeah, in the beginning, I was a little bit confused, you see, because this term is not familiar to me. And I couldn't understand what they are saying. And then they show some examples, you see, and this and that. I went to some like mental clinics, and I met many. And then there were some professors who are guiding them, and they came to listen my teaching talk, not teaching talk. Very small group, about seven. And then they were explaining all about it. Then I just said, okay, now instead of giving my talk, you just explain about this, okay, how it happens. It's not familiar to me, so just explain me. And then Stefan is a very good professor, Norwegian professor. And then he explained, and we became a very good friend. And we talked at dinner, during the dinner we talked, during the lunch we talked. And slowly, slowly, then I understood, you see. And then I thought, okay, why it is happening? And then In Israel, I give all this answer what I'm giving today. I say that if you really sincerely, totally dedicate yourself or dedicate certain sort of potential or proficiency or whatever, if you just sincerely help money or like this, and then work for them, if you sincerely, if possible out of compassion or out of unconditional love, if possible out of bodhicitta, this will not make you tired. Instead, this will give you more energy, more positive energy, and more happiness, and then most importantly, a lot of satisfaction. This satisfaction, by helping someone with a pure heart, if you help, if you succeed them, they will cry after helping, they smile. And it gives so much satisfaction. And this satisfaction really takes all our tiredness. It takes all our tiredness. It gives so much inspiration to do more. And all this generosity and everything is like this. Therefore, Shantideva, again, in this chapter, he says, this is big conclusion by him. Komna, if we try to familiarize, if we try to practice, and make very, very familiar or close to your mind some good things or anything, And then this becomes easier and easier and easier. There's nothing, no problem will remain solid and difficult, you see. If we just go on trying to solve this problem, and it becomes easier and easier. To achieve something also become, there's nothing remain difficult, you see. If we try, it will become easier and easier. And of course, he is explaining according to his experience. The big question to me, how he achieved bodhicitta, you see, Shantideva, because he remained in Nalanda University, and he didn't do anything. He just close his drawer. When he need food, he goes and take food. And when he has to go to the toilet, he goes to the toilet. And then almost like he closed the door and then he just in his room. And there were so many teachers, spiritual teachers, who has a lot of suspect that now he is just throwing his toilet and eating the food and then sleeping. So he knows only three things, you see. They nicknamed him as a Busuko. Busuko means Dushyasumba. In Tibetan, he says Dushyasumba. Dushyasumba means he knows that when something is coming out, he knows that he has to throw. And he has a sense of if he gets hungry, he needs a food. And he sleeps. He knows only three things. Nicknamed him, you see. And they looked down him. And they planned to kick him out. Kick him out, you see. But then they didn't kick him out like you are sleeping and kidding, so you have to go out. Instead, they planned that everyone has to turn wise, everyone is keep teaching in front of all these great teachers. And then they thought that he didn't know anything. So he has to go out. But when his turn came, and they put a very high throne, and then even the king at that time was invited, and then they asked, now they are making face, you see. Now see. Now what he will say, like this. And he said calmly, and he said, do I need to teach something which Buddha never taught, or do I need to teach something which already Buddha taught? And then he he taught this teaching, okay, Bodhisattva. And at a certain level, okay, he stayed in the on the throne, and everyone was listening. And then when he started teaching, and everyone goes, wow. This is American expression, okay? Wow. Wow. Wow, okay. Yeah. This is all because of the mind, okay? Body is doing nothing. Body was doing nothing. Just throwing and eating, okay? But mind is functioning. Mind is practicing, okay? Okay, practicing, practicing. This is quite difficult to understand, you see. How much he taught in one chapter, okay? We didn't read each and every stanzas. But if you read each and every stanza, it's so, so good, you see. These are all he practiced. But he, in the beginning, he says that, I am not a great writer, and I'm not a very profound practitioner, and I don't have any intention to be benefited by my text, but I really wanted to write this just to inspire myself in the beginning. It's like this. But now, okay, since he wrote this book, so many people realize the practice of bodhicitta. So the mind can do a lot, yeah. And another text which is shorter version of Bodhisattva's way of life, and that he put it in the bin, and then they later because some of them they heard about 10 chapter, some of them heard only 9 chapter, and then to confirm. And then they went to him, said that which one is correct. And he said, 10 chapter is correct. And then if you need where I took all these teachings, it's all rooted to Buddha's teaching. And then all this, the quotations from Buddha's teaching, I condensed into a smaller paper, scripture than this, and it is in the... And then they went and searched. Yeah. So the talk is that the mind is so much potential, okay? So much potential. It's unbelievable, you see. Now these days, scientific or technology, it's unbelievable, isn't it? Yeah, there's a very small thing calling to India. Then it rings there, you see. If this is told, if I tell this to some place, remote place where there's no mobile phone like this, they will not believe. But then if I bring them to the city and then give this and teach this and then call, and they say, I see this is possible. So I think now I stop. Is it? Yeah. The two chapter, are you clear? The fourth chapter is, okay, by having the precepts or vows of Bodhisattva, and then to act according to that perception, whether it's related with the physical action, or speech, or mental action. So try to maintain this. Try not to do any bad thing. Try not to break any of the Bodhisattva's vow. And try to maintain the Bodhisattva's vow and try to do all the good things. And this process, okay, then we say that this person has a bhaya, which is the fourth chapter. And to do this stronger and better, and then next chapter, fifth chapter, is to be vigilant what is going on in your thought, which is more dangerous, you see. It can lead us to hell. It can lead us also enlightenment, you see. So this is all because of the mind. Therefore, to guard your mind and all the time to be vigilant, what is going on in your mind is the most important. That is the essence of the fifth chapter. Okay? With this, then I stop. Thank you so much. Yeah.